Hey guys, Shane here with One Shift at a Time. Are you ready for a long one? I think this is going to be a long one. This is probably going to be my longest video yet. Definitely the most work I've ever put into a video, so please, I'm going to start this one at the start. Like, share, subscribe, please do it for me. So, let's talk about the drought. If you're Canadian, you probably already know what drought I'm talking about. 28 years. Again, do I need to say more? I mean, that should be enough said, but here we go. June 9th, 1993. That's the last time a Canadian team was able to hoist the Lord Stanley up above their heads. And that's a sad thing because, I mean, there are not many players playing in the NHL right now that were alive last time that happened. And we all know that I think it was only 3 years ago that it was the first time in the history of the NHL that less than 50% of the players in the league were Canadian. So it's really, really embarrassing because we as Canadians really feel this is our sport, and it does not show it by champions. The championships definitely have been in America for 28 years now. I think we're just going to talk about it and talk about how we got there, talk about the games, and then how close we've come since. We're going to talk about those series too. So from 1984 to 1993, so the 10 years prior to our 28-year drought, Canada won 8 of 10 cups. The only two cups we didn't win were 1991, 1992, and 1992-93 by the Pittsburgh Penguins. Really dominating, right up to the point where the cup stopped. We were really dominating, and since then, that was the last time Canada won the cup. And as I said, we're gonna look at those. But let's start off by talking about that series. So again, June 9th, 1993, and Wayne Gretzky on his brand new team had dragged the LA Kings all the way to the Stanley Cup. They would run into a team that was setting OT records. That year, Montreal, I don't remember how many, they won almost all their games in overtime. It was absolutely insane. The Heart Attack Kids, Patrick Waugh, it was just absolutely insane that year. He went 16-4 with a 2.13 goals against and a 9.29 save percentage. That was in the 90s, early 90s. There was a lot of scoring, and I don't know, there was this guy on the ice called Wayne Gretzky, the greatest player to ever live. And yeah, when you put up numbers like that, it is absolutely impressive. There's no other way to say it. And it was a good old Vinny Danfus as far as the forwards. He led the way, 11 goals, 12 assists, 23 points. This is one of my best earlier memories of hockey. I started watching, I don't want to age myself too much, but I started watching about 86, 87. And I was a little younger at those ages, but I really remember the last two Oiler ones, the Flames one and this one, very clearly. I remember watching the games. So let's talk about the next one then. And for that one, we don't have to go very far. In fact, it was the very next year we got our next kick of the can, as it were. And this time it was the Canucks. And the Canucks surprised everyone. I don't think anyone really saw this coming. I mean, they got past both Alberta teams. And we know Edmonton was on the decline at that point. They had won their last cup. They lost Gretzky. They lost Messier. They lost everyone by that point. And they, I believe, were in second last in the Pacific. The Oilers were. But they got past the Flames there in the, I believe it was the first round. Yes, they beat the Flames in the first round that year, but they actually started 7th in the West, so again, I don't think a lot of people saw them getting there, but they did go and they beat Calgary in the first round, then they beat Dallas in the second, and I know how weird is this, but they beat Toronto in the Western Conference Finals to make their date with the big bad Broad Street Bullies, the New York Rangers. And the Rangers had gotten there by beating the Islanders in the first round, the Capitals in the second round, and the Devils to make the final, which was a Montan Brodeur-led Devils. So that is pretty impressive to get past them. New York Rangers quickly went up 3-1, and I think a lot of people thought it was over. But then the Canucks stormed back in games 5 and 6 to push that 7th game, and I don't have to tell Canuck fans about that crossbar. They came down, hit a crossbar, and unfortunately I believe it was Adam Graves. Now this is a long time ago, so if I got the wrong names, I'm very sorry, but I believe it was Adam Graves went the other way and scored, put it up 3-2, and that was it. That's the way it ended. And I, again, this is a long time ago, but I think the New York ended a 40-year Stanley Cup drought by doing that. So it was really good for them. They haven't won one since again, so they're on another big drought too, but not as bad as Canada's drought. Then, unfortunately, it was a much longer time before our next chance, and that chance would be in 2004. And again, it came out of nowhere. I don't think anyone, when that season or playoffs began, thought that the sixth in the West Calgary Flames were going to make a run at it. They had a massive battle. All game, the Game 7 battle against Vancouver was very intense. I remember watching that and not thinking good things while we went through that, but they did manage to come out ahead. And then they quite easily beat Detroit and San Jose 4-2 respectively to make themselves right into the finals. Tampa on the other side, they were contenders. They finished first in the East that year. I think most people expected them to get to the Stanley Cup. This was their first Stanley Cup berth, and it was a chance to get their first ever cup. And a cup to Florida, which at the time seemed really strange. Nowadays, it doesn't seem so strange, as Tampa might win their back-to-back this year. Who knows? They're looking very strong. So when Calgary went down, then they started, of course, in Tampa, and they split the games there, 1-1. They came back to Calgary and split again, 2-2. Went back to Tampa, won the very pivotal Game 5, and they had a chance to come home and win it at home. And a lot of people think they did. It was 6 minutes and 57 seconds remaining in the third, a 2-2 score, and a puck came across to Martin Gelinas and across the line. I believe across the line. I'll show the footage. I'm going to try showing a lot more footage in this. I really hope I don't get any strikes or anything. This one is like 15-year-old footage. Hopefully it's not too too copyright infringed, but I do believe they scored here. Should have probably won the cup, as the game did go to overtime. Tampa scored in overtime, then took it back to Tampa, and as we all know, won the cup. So definitely, I think that's the closest we've come to winning the cup. And again, we're not going to have to wait long for the next one, so we'll see you with the Oilers. So this one was another huge surprise, as the Oilers had missed the playoffs the year before, and they just, I mean, not year, I guess, season technically, because that was the year before, the year between the Flames making the Stanley Cups and the Oilers making the Stanley Cup final, there was that strike year. So for all intents and purposes, it was the next season, not next year, but for the last season, the Oilers missed the playoffs, and this season they barely scraped in. They got that eighth and final spot, just beating the Canucks by 2 points there, so literally scraped into the playoffs. But I mean, that's why we play the postseason, because you never know what's going to happen. And the Oilers started out by dispatching the Detroit Red Wings in six, then the Sharks also in six, before they really started gaining steam, beating the Anaheim Ducks 4-1, and this was looking like it. Rolison was playing awesome, and this was the team. Who'd they have? Number 44, Chris Pronger. It was just, he came to that team that season. He was a rental player just for that one season, but he turned that defensive core around that season. On the other side, we had the Hurricanes, and they came to the Cup final by beating the Canadiens in six. Then in round two, they had the Devils, and they beat them in five. And then in the Sabres took them to Game 7 in the Eastern Finals, and that's what brought them to the dance. So, unfortunately, Game 1, I think, is where this series was pretty much decided. The Oilers did really good to fight back, and I give them a lot of props for it, but Game 1, 5 minutes and 54 seconds remaining in the third period in a 4-4 tie, and there is a collision in the crease. Bergeron and Ladd, and unfortunately, Rolison, and he got the worst of it, and he was not seen for the rest of the series. He was playing so good, he brought them right there, and when you gotta play with your backup goalies in the finals, it is tough. I give good credit to the boys, they did really well, but yeah, it's tough. So the Oilers lost that game, 5-4 in overtime, then they lost the next one, a big one, 5-0, and I think a lot of people were like, it's over now, the Oilers lost their goalie and they're losing 5-0, but then they split the next team, both 2-1 each way, and they brought the series to a respectable 3-1, and then they won the next two to push Game 7, and believe me, as someone who lives in oil country, their belief was real, and this place was pumping. Unfortunately, that is where they ended, though. They did lose 3-1, and once again, we had to watch an American team win their first Stanley Cup, and the drought managed to continue. Then, for the third season in a row, a Canadian team has a chance, And after they finished second in the Northeast and fourth in the East, the Ottawa Senators were actually looking pretty darn good. And they started by going against the Pittsburgh Penguins, who they dispatched in five. Next, they set the Devils home in five again. And then finally, the Sabres in five. So here they are, the Ottawa Senators in the Stanley Cup Finals, and they've only lost three games. This is it. This is our chance, right, Canada? Yeah, I wouldn't be making this video if that was the case. Unfortunately, they were met by the no longer Mighty Ducks. They're just the Ducks. They changed their names, I believe, two seasons before, and it seemed to be working. They're a lot more serious team. I believe Corey Perry's now on the other... Or, Corey Perry, sorry. Oh, man, I can't think of his name. Now Chris Pronger, I believe, is on the Ducks. So, yeah, he made the Stanley Cup playoff finals 2 years in a row, which is very impressive. And unfortunately, they made it to... But as they the no longer Mighty Ducks do, and they turned to the Ducks a couple of years further, they were planning on playing Disney Villain. They also crushed their first two rounds, both by a score of 4-1 over the Wild and the Canucks, before the Red Wings took them to 6. Unfortunately for the fans north of the border, this was not even a close one. After three cushy Game 7 losses, the Game 7's bowed out in just 5. And unfortunately for fans north of the border, this was not even close. After three crushing Game 7 losses, the Sens bowed out in just 5. So we only have one more team to get to, unfortunately, before we are done this drought video. So, and it took 4 more seasons for the next chance, and it was a good one. The Canucks were not surprising anyone this time. They were fresh off their first ever President's Trophy win, and not just by a little bit. They were 10 points ahead of the closest person in the league that year. They were just the best team in the regular season by far. So the playoffs, they seemed to continue where they left off. They went to the first round against a very dangerous, always dangerous Chicago Blackhawks team. And that went to 7. Then they took the Predators in 6, who was also a really good team at the time. And then they rolled the Sharks 4-1, and here we are. We have a Vancouver Canucks home ice advantage in the Stanley Cup playoffs. This is our best chance. They, of course, were met by the Bruins. The Bruins had a really tough go in the first round again as well. They were taking on the Montreal Canadiens, and it took them 7 games to beat them. Then they swept the Flyers before once again going to 7 games against another dangerous Tampa Bay Lightning team to get their berth into the Stanley Cup Finals. And the Stanley Cup Finals started off well for the Canucks. They won both their games at home. Then they went to Boston. Boston won both their games at home. Back to Vancouver. Vancouver wins. Back to Boston. Boston wins. Back to Vancouver. Vancouver should win, right? No, they got embarrassed 4-0. The only thing more embarrassing and ugly than that loss was the riots that followed, unfortunately. That is going to be a scar on Vancouver, and for a while, that was really ugly. You don't want to be rioting over a sports loss. There are very, very more important things to be rioting over. Trust me, it's not a sports match. That unfortunately ended that chance, and that's where we end off. Which, I mean, unfortunately, that brings us to the end of the video, but you're like, wait, Shane, you've missed the last 10 years, you can't just skip that. Well, why not? Canada's missed getting to the Stanley Cup Final for those 10 years. I mean, I wish. A Canadian team has not made the finals since 2010, 2011, and as a country, our hopes are with the Montreal Canadiens this year and their underdogs, which, if we look at the past, underdog seems to be better than favorite. We'll see how it goes, but I mean, is this the year? Who knows? No pressure. It's only a whole country on your Canadians. They just tied it up tonight, one game each with the Golden Knights, so there's a chance. They stole one in Vegas, which if you can steal one in the other team's barn, that is definitely a good shot. So definitely, good luck to them. We're all cheering for you as a country now. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. As I said, it definitely was... probably my longest video as to date, and definitely the most work I've had to put into a video, so I really hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please hit that like, subscribe, share this thing around. You know the drill. I appreciate everything you guys do, and we'll see you in the next episode.